So we're now going to the breakout sessions, and all of you will have a choice of a topic. There will be three different topics. So now you've gone through the ideation sessions, you have some ideas, you kind of are thinking about what you could potentially do for the hackathon part. And so the breakout sessions are really meant to be a deep dive into a specific area. And you'll the next workshop, which will be in this space, will be with Isita and Roshi on saving the planet and the power of AI. So hi everyone, how many of you have heard about AI? You know, the artificial intelligence, the crazy technology which some people say may take over the world. How many of you, raise your hands. Okay, but how many of you guys have heard, and how many of you guys have heard about climate change? Pretty sure everyone here has. So these are two very important things. One is a very important issue and one is a very important solution. So our workshop will be about combining the two and using AI to solve different problems in climate change. I'm Isita. I was an alumni of the Stanford AI for All Summer Program and this project. I'll be covering a few cases where it was used in the real world, where real scientists at universities like looked at data from different government sources, from their own like equipment, and they use their own data and they made it. As for our project, the tutorial, we will be using some kind of standard data, like one of the most basic ones we use for. Okay, so now that we know about AI, it's time to analyze how real researchers in different universities, government locations, use AI to solve issues in climate change. Humans wouldn't be able to find. And so this one used different, like a lot of different information from like different power plants. They used working hours, the height of the plant, the smoke plumes, and they did that so that people could plan to make these kind of power plants much more efficient and use less energy. And this is using the decision tree algorithm, which is very good for classification. And so it kind of classified how much pollution, will it be very dangerous, will it be like almost non-existent. And this project managed to get an 82.4% accuracy. And since this is a 2011 project, it shows that we do have improved a lot, considering that someone like Orochi, who just went to a summer program, could also get an accuracy of 92%. Okay. And this one is going to be with an artificial neural network, which is a little bit about what Orochi covered. And this uses pictures of satellite data of urban areas to figure out how much light pollution there is and how urban it is. So this is a two-step process actually. The main goal of this project was to figure out how urban a place is, how much city is there, is it more rural or is it like there's a lot of buildings, a lot of factories, but there's not that much data for that. And it's actually kind of subjective. Like, how do you describe, like, what is a city? There's too many different parameters. So they simplified it and instead looked at light data, because you can tell how urban a place is by how many lights go on at night. Like, as you can see in this picture, you can see that some of these areas are probably major cities, and then these areas are probably more rural because there's less light. And this used one of the most powerful and also traditional algorithms of AI called the artificial neural network. And it's also an example of computer vision, using AI to analyze images. This kind of algorithm usually takes an image, kind of divides it into pixels, and then just sees like these patterns between the lines, the colors, like what's similar about them, what's different. And this is a relatively recent one, 2018, so they have managed to get 97.8% accuracy, which is incredibly good. Of course, these kind of projects can always be improved, as sometimes AI algorithms, especially artificial neural networks, are very kind of black box. People don't really know what's going on through the program, what is like really they're deciding, what makes one pattern better to follow than another. And so that's why with different like parameters and different like adjustments to the code, the accuracy is better. Okay. So here's a quick summary of what we've learned so far. Artificial intelligence and machine learning can be used extensively in the field of climate change. And as long as it's some sort of a classification problem or a prediction problem, AI is very, very good. So now we're going to try opportunity to put information like normal text and the Python code in one place. It's very useful because I don't have a program downloaded to run all this. I'm just doing it from Google. So any of you guys can make these kind of notebooks and use them to teach other people about AI, to share your projects. And if you guys open it, you will see a button in the top left corner that says open in Playground, which will allow you to edit it. And you guys can like play around with the code on your own like free time. Right now we'll be going through a quick tutorial of how to use an ANN for the purpose of classifying iris reports. Okay. So this one is called AI in Google. So we've already seen that AI needs data to perform, and we're going to be using our AI knowledge on a data set of iris flowers. Iris flowers, you can classify them into, I think, three or four different categories based on their petal length and sepal length. And while this is not a very, this is not a complex computer vision algorithm, this one uses already given numerical information. So we'll be having length data and number data for the sepal length, width, petal length, and width. In a real computer vision thing, you would get just the whole image file, and the computer and the algorithm would kind of analyze each of the pixels in there. But since this is an intro tutorial, we'll be sticking with something more numerical. So there's 150 different examples, and this is pretty small. Sometimes AI projects, especially artificial neural network projects, can have up to 30,000. When I was at Stanford AI for All, my project was using RNA sequences to diagnose and classify cancer, and we had, I think, 30,000 different RNA sequences for four different types of cancer. Okay. And we'll be using this data set, we'll be using the iris one from, it's from a university. Here's the link to the data set here. You can download the file yourself if you want, but you don't have to for this tutorial, it's already. So the first things first, we need to import the data set and kind of clean it up. So here are a few of the libraries. Libraries have a lot of functions in the code that we don't want to type out. I mean, sure, we could technically fully, like by hand, code every single part of the neural network, but that's time consuming and sometimes inefficient because people who make the libraries have already tested this out. So the first thing we're going to do is read in our data set with this PD, pandas data frame.readcd. And to run these things, you do shift and basically here we also made sure that these classified them the species, which were originally in word form, into numbers. So anything that was a setosa species now has a label of 0, anything that was versicolor has a label of 1, and anything that was virginica has a label of 2. That makes it easier on the neural network to kind of analyze it because it's in plain numbers. Here, you would, if you were doing this project yourself, you would have downloaded a CSV file, like a comma-separated file, kind of like a spreadsheet, into your own computer and then uploaded it here. To make it convenient, I have a link to the data set on GitHub. But make sure that when you're actually doing it, you should be doing it from there. Okay, now we'll be trying to visualize our data. So as you can see, we imported a few libraries called Seaboard, and that one is for visualization, as long as Matplotlib. Here we'll be showing you how to like kind of graph the data so we can make some assumptions. And as you can see, we have a few graphs of like different things. So we have here sepal length versus petal length. And this is species 0, 1, and 2. So as you can see, species 0, most of them will have pretty small petal lengths and pretty small petal widths. While species 2 and 1 are a little bit higher. And this shows a little bit of that decision tree classification thing that you see. And that's how you kind of manually do it. You'd be like, oh, there's like certain irises have shorter things, that's one class, certain irises have longer petals, that's another class. And here are other comparisons between the two things. And so, since they're all very distinct places, you can clearly see that there are some things that dictate what type of iris is what. It's not very important. So here we have the ANN. This is the real thing. Now that we've already like imported our data, we can start the... So, we are splitting it into training and testing as we have already covered. And here we have this function called the train test split, which we are using from this library, sklearn model selection. And here we're changing our labels to one hot hat. basically this makes it again even more easy for the neural network to see. So instead of having 0, 1, and 2, we have three different categories. Is it a 0, is it a 1, and is it a 2? So if it's 0, then only the first column will be checked. If it's 1, only the second column. And if it's 2, only the third. And here we also have the outputs, so the Y train and the Y test in the same split in about 3. So our training set has both labels and features. So the input data and the output data, because that's what the AI needs to know to kind of establish our app. So here's a quick diagram of our neural network. It has an input layer, which is where all the features go in, like our pedal length, our steeple length, and these are all hidden layers. And each of these kind of paths has different weights on it, and they have like numbers. Like perhaps if you go to this path, you'll get one output. If you go to that path, you'll get another one. And that's it's a very complex thing. And in fact, real AI things have like a lot of hidden layers. Making this model, except it won't look like this, it'll look like this. So first thing, we add an input layer with four dimensions because we have four different things that we're looking at. Then the second thing we do is add another layer, so one of these hidden layers. And the hidden layer has 50 different nodes, 50 different circles. And the activation function, which is kind of helps translate, standardize these for the next layer, is the ReLU function. And these are kind of, you can research them on your own. I'm using some standard ones. And then remember, Marshi talked about overfitting. Here we're going to use the function dropout, which kind of hides a few of the outputs so that the neural network doesn't depend too much on whatever the training data is. It kind of tells it, oh, don't look at these, you just figure it out on your own. That way it makes less assumptions. Finally, we have the output layer, which gives you which is the three types of classes, 0, 1, or 2, and it has an activation function. So finally, we come pilot. And if you will now train. So for training, it's just called fitting it. Basically, we have to pick all of those little circles, have different weights on them, and training it figures out what kind of weights there are. Like how much is one path versus another. And so it is true that artificial neural networks do take some time to train, but that's for the very big ones. This shouldn't actually take too long at all. As you can see, it's trained just now, and we can see that the accuracy has slowly increased over time. It started with like a 46% accuracy and came up to a 70. And that's kind of how the neural network works. Each time it does a training round, it learns like, oh, maybe I shouldn't do this next time, and then it gets better. So now we're going to get the prediction accuracy with a few different functions, which I don't know. And so now we have the prediction accuracy is 60%, and this is not that great, right? So what can we do to solve it? We have to tune the parameters. When I was here, I was telling you about different things like an activation function, how many layers there are. All those things can be changed to improve your neural network significantly. So here, we're going to try adding a second hidden layer and seeing if it improves it. And our second hidden layer has 300 this time. And we're also going to train it in the same step. So as you can see, it started at 30, but now it's at 95, which is significantly better than the 70% accuracy we got before. Now we can try the prediction again, and we have a 90% accuracy. And 60 to 90 is a huge jump. And you can keep adjusting all these parameters, seeing if you can get better and better. And sometimes just due to the like distribution of the training sets, you might get different accuracies from one run to the other. But you know you're doing good as long as pretty much everything, all the time you've been doing the testing is above whatever your goal threshold is, 93 or 95. Okay. So that's all for this specific ANN tutorial. If you have any questions, you can email me at this. Below this, we also have a few tutorials on decision trees, the other algorithm that you need. And we'll also be showing a way to analyze accuracy called the confusion matrix. This is a pretty explanatory tutorial. All the information and a lot of the learning part is also in this text place. All you have to do to keep running it is press shift enter for all of these gray boxes. Okay, now we'll be opening it up to a bit of Q&A. You can ask us about a little bit about AI, you can ask us about AI for all. We're like open to your guys. Just the battery. So if anybody have anything you want to ask. Okay, so we have a few questions
for you guys now. How do you guys think you can use what you learned today to help solve different
thing before we end this presentation. We have, I've compiled a resource guide of different resources you guys can use to study AI. It has a few things like different online courses. It has, I think, some even some courses that aren't just technical AI. I think there's one with how to use AI in business. And those resources are really helpful for you to learn. And once you have this basic coding stuff down, as long as you have data, you can do a neural network. You can do a decision tree. It's a very actually open procedure. A lot of sites like Kaggle have the data for different competitions that they host like open, so you can use it. Just one thing to be very careful about with data is that you should always be using data with an ethical source and ethically like classified. So if you guys are using medical data in any way, maybe to like check the effects of pollution on people, all the data, patient data should be de-identified. There should be no names associated with the data. It should be collected from willing patients. And sometimes it's very hard for you to investigate this yourself. So the best places to get data are from official sites like Kaggle, who like are well renowned for hosting these AI making data science competitions, as well as the government. The government has like their own data set of many different things. And universities, because universities are also kind of held to certain standards. Do you guys have any other questions on AI in climate change?
How do you engage with marginalized community members, people who don't want to or don't feel safe offering their information? You're telling me to go to viable sources which are very helpful and useful and embedded and productive. However, there are communities that aren't always addressed in those numbers, and very necessary given that some people, there's a culture or language barrier.
So that's something that, like in any statistics problem, it's very hard to go and fix those biases. Like there's measurement bias, there's non-response bias. And those are things that, since we're only students, we don't know as much about. But I think the best way would probably, for the people who gather the data, it would be their responsibility to fix those non-response bias and all those measurement biases.
Yeah.
Because we, as the people getting the data, we won't be having the resources to go and ask around just like, hey, do you do this, this, and this in your life, right? We're just the people who take in the data and play around with it.
Okay, and then actually there are a few ways that you as the like AI person can do this. There are, you can look up organizations which specifically are like meant for this. A lot of newer data organizations or places which try to do data are really focusing on this. It's become a really huge issue, like bias in AI. And as it's a very important technology, people need to make sure that it's equal, that there aren't any societal biases in there. So definitely you can feel free to ask. If you're getting it from like a professor or a university, you can ask them, do you know like if this data is like diverse, like from where did you get it? And like especially communicating with these people will also show them that you really care about it and will inspire them to care about it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Comments?
I think since we have a little bit of extra time, let's do a very short quiz.
Yeah, why don't we do that?
Because why not? Okay, so who here can tell me what is artificial intelligence? Like the very general basic form. Yeah?
Is it a
very
system?
Right. And how would you describe machine learning within artificial intelligence? Anyone? Y'all just got a zero on this test, I guess.
Okay, so we'll move on to another test. I'm going to test you a little bit on what did I teach you guys with this code. I was referring to input and output as with specific terms. Do you remember what they were? One of them starts with an F, one of them starts with an L. If you may, you guys might not have caught it, but I can tell you. So, anybody know what was I calling? It was actually features and labels. That's the traditional AI and computer science terminology for the input variables and the output variables. So, in the case of the iris data set,